Welcome to the Prefect Report, where faith, family, and freedom meet. I'm Peter Juister, your host on a journey through life's vital topics. Join me as we explore inspiring stories, practical insights, and meaningful conversations that matter most to you. Let's dive into faith, strengthen our families, and celebrate freedom together. This is Prefect Report. Happy Independence Day, everyone. I know I'm only 4 days late, but Jesus took also 4 days to raise Lazarus from the dead. Today is really a special day for freedom lovers all over the world. Since quite recently, Julian Assange has been released from prison, and it is quite significant in its timing, since it has an appeal of prophetic significance, being that it happened so close to the 4th of July. The topic of freedom for me is really that God has a bigger plan than our own blessed assurance in mind, and He wants all people around the world to taste the joy and the freedom that we have in Jesus Christ. My topic of discussion today is titled The Rejection in Samaria, A Lesson in Mercy. This is about the encounter that Jesus and his disciples had with a group of Samaritans that rejected Jesus once they had become privy to the fact that he was on his way to Jerusalem. And as a result, two of Jesus' disciples, including John, wanted to call down fire from heaven to destroy that city, just like Elijah did back in the Old Testament. It reads as follows, Luke 9, verse 51 to 56 in the NIV. As the time approached for him to be taken up to heaven, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem, and he sent messengers on ahead who went into a Samaritan village to get things ready for him. But the people there did not welcome him because he was heading for Jerusalem. When the disciples, James and John, saw this, they asked, "Lord, do you want us to call fire down from heaven to destroy them?" But Jesus turned and rebuked them. Then he and his disciples went on to another village. My purpose for this podcast has to do about forgiveness and how forgiveness ties in with our ability to increase in our faith and to trust in God. How vital is it that we should walk in forgiveness every hour and every minute of every day? The real irony in this story has to do with the Samaritans, because the mountain that they were located at and preferred to worship God at was Mount Gerizim, which was the mount to the south of Shechem and the opposite of Mount Ebal, where God had commanded the Israelites to divide up and stand in the midst of, as the leaders proclaimed both blessing and curses upon them, as they had heard the requirements of the covenant that they were to keep. The significance of this passage in Scripture for me is in relation to people that were once passionate for God, or as the more popular term in today's language says it, on fire for God, but now have lost the zeal that they once had. And it's really baffling to understand, because we often think that it is because of temptation and sin that people lose the momentum that they once had for the kingdom. But there is a deeper rooted issue at play here to describe it at best, and it is the most elemental aspect of Christianity, and where our walk with the Lord begins. The Samaritans were very happy to receive Messiah Jesus when they first encountered him through the woman at the well in John 4 verse 5 to 7. They were glad to receive the good news of the gospel, and they were happy to be considered by the Lord for the forgiveness of sins. In fact, the Samaritans have a rich history in the part where they were located, and the mountain where they worshipped. Because Mount Gerizim is actually a place where the Israelites were proclaimed a blessing over once they set foot in the promised land called Israel. The two mounts that were opposite each other were called Mount Gerizim and Mount Ebal, where the Israelites renewed their covenant with God, and where the tribe of Israel were split into two. And the heads of the tribes stood both on one side speaking blessing, and the other side pronounced cursing from Mount Ebal into the valley of Shechem, where the people of Israel were gathered together. The Samaritans were on the side of blessing the people of Israel, while the north proclaimed cursing as a reminder for the people of Israel to keep the covenant and to stay faithful to God, as there are both blessing for obedience and cursing for disobedience to the covenant. The Jews of the tribe of Judah, with whom the Samaritans were in a rift against, were believed to be in more doctrinal purity compared to the Samaritans. They also seemed to be preachers of doom and punishment of the letter, rather than preachers of prosperity. Jesus may have alluded to the following when he was teaching the parable of the Good Samaritan, that he helped a man who was beaten and robbed and left for dead, while the priest and the other people went around a long way, ignoring the man. As doctrinally imperfect as the Samaritan may have been, he knew that it was the right thing to do, and that was to show mercy, which is what God desires. God wants mercy and obedience instead of sacrifice. The Samaritans were in fact the first people that God called upon in preparation for the fulfillment of the new covenant as described in John 4 verse 5 to 7. But because they rejected Jesus, someone else had to take their place, which I believe was the woman with the alabaster box of costly oil who anointed the feet of Jesus. Now, this is only a theory, but Jesus first approached the woman at the well as a door to preach to the people of Samaria, and they greatly accepted him at first. But after Jesus came back through that area, they found out that he was going to visit their arch enemies in Jerusalem. And because they took offense at this, they missed a very important part of God's plan to bless the house of Israel. God then used a woman who is described by the Pharisees in Luke 7 to be a sinful woman to finish the job of preparing Jesus for his death, burial, and resurrection. Because of Samaria's prejudices, God couldn't heal the rift that was happening to unify the people of Israel. And really, at the end of the day, we only see a remnant of Israel that is saved until this day. The gospel was preached to outsiders and the Gentiles more than it has been preached to the house of Israel in order to provoke them to jealousy. Something great could have happened here, but the Samaritans refused to be a part of it, and through their reluctance as a result of that unforgiveness, they missed out greatly. A place that was once visited by a great move of God now became a place of death and cursing. So much for once saved, always saved. Forgiveness is the key to both receive, remain, and grow in our relationship with God through Jesus Christ. The other significant revelation in this passage is that you cannot move forward into the depths of God's will for your life when you have not learned to let go of the past. This includes offenses towards the church and the Jewish people at large. The Samaritans had a revelation of the past which God did not call them to keep at that point, but was to move beyond, as Jesus said, there will come a day where worshippers will worship not there nor in Jerusalem, but they will worship God in spirit and in truth, for this is what God desires. The Messianic kingdom through redemption and forgiveness was proclaimed by King David and his son Solomon, where the temple had been built. Mount Gerizim and Mount Ebal represented the old covenant that represented the fading glory through which God visited Moses and wanted to speak to Israel, but they rejected because of fear. Therefore, God had to establish a covenant through which he could deal with his people based upon their obedience or their disobedience for God's commandments to them. Joshua, Moses' successor, was the first one who built an altar upon Mount Ebal, which stands opposite of Mount Gerizim, and I cannot for some reason explain why this was so, as I would have to dig much deeper into the meaning of such. But let's continue. The Samaritans assumed, because they were in the physical location where God commanded blessings upon Israel through his leaders and prophets, that they were, so to speak, the chosen ones, and this resulted in a manner of pride and arrogance to come from them, maintaining a rift between them and the rest of Israel, especially the Jews in Jerusalem. The Jews of Jerusalem in turn hated the Samaritans because they had been colonized by foreign adversaries and intermarried with them. In other words, the rest of the country of the Jews thought they were impure. The plumb line of this is that people can get stuck in the blessings of God, albeit past revelations, dogmas, they get denominational and divisive, and they get completely lost in translation concerning where God is moving and where God desires us to be at this very moment. People also get territorial regarding inheritance, that is, promises of God, of land and resources. This group thinks that they are the original beneficiaries of a revelation or a piece of land, and likewise, the other group thinks they are too. We can also get stuck in one mount or the other, blessing or cursing. One speaks of judgment and divine retribution against disobedience, and the other speaks of promises and blessings that can turn as a result into a prosperity club. What I believe the Samaritans missed is that in spite of their claim to fame and their hubris self-aggrandized upliftment in the history of God's people and his covenant with them, is that they did not understand that faith is really an issue of the heart, and God wants to restore relationship with his people through the redemption that he provides, rather than a blessing and a cursing through a law-based covenant that doesn't really restore us to where we are supposed to be. Jesus clearly said that we will worship in spirit and in truth. It's not a physical position, but a posture and condition of the heart, but particularly a heart that is redeemed through its knowledge of God's forgiveness through his Son. So, on one side, racism happened against the Samaritans, meaning their practices weren't considered all Jewish and their offspring weren't pure. And on the other side, there was arrogance and pride, thinking that the Messiah had come to bring only blessing and prosperity to them. But they lost the plot altogether because they weren't thinking outside of themselves to God's salvation, to the Jews, and subsequently the world altogether. The reason I'm bringing all of this up is because the church is entering a season where God is going to greatly bless us if we keep our focus on God. If we are unable to let go of the past and of past judgment of those who have hurt and offended us, we won't be able to continue on in the season where God would have us to be, and consequently we will also lose the blessing that we think we had. Luke 17 verse 1 to 6 in the NIV, I want to read. Jesus said to his disciples, "Things that caused people to stumble are bound to come, but woe to anyone through whom they come. It would be better for them to be thrown into the sea with a millstone tied around the neck, rather than to cause one of these little ones to stumble. So watch yourselves. If brother or sister sins against you, rebuke them. And if they repent, forgive them. Even if they sin against you 7 times in a day, and 7 times come back to you saying, 'I repent,' you must forgive them." The apostles said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." To which he replied, "If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it will obey you." The faith that you and I need to progress into the season that God has in store for us is exactly linked to our ability to forgive and forget. Forgiveness is the most elemental and often most ignored requirement of the Christian faith. God is sending us into a season where we will either exact accountability for those who have wronged us, because it will look like the world is going into one direction of conflict and hatred, whereas God will bless those who keep their eyes fixed on him. It will require us to really go deep into the root of our faith lest we are tempted to take matters into our own hands and try to do it ourselves and play God. God is asking us to let go. Let go of all the people you placed your hope in to give you an opportunity or to promote you or to help you move forward in life. Whether it is your parents or your boss and your workplace, or whether it is the leaders in your church you sought after to give you advice and to help you, but left you disappointed and hurt. The reality is that hurt people hurt other people. So we have a choice whether we want to perpetuate the cycle of unforgiveness or extend mercy and invite God into the process of heaven invading earth and destroying the darkness that keeps people in a prison of hatred and vengeance towards one another. Forgiveness is therefore the key that releases you to grab a hold of what God has in store for you, and that forgiveness is found only in Jesus Christ. We are therefore called to imitate Jesus, knowing that as we are forgiven our trespasses and sins, we are also extending that grace and mercy towards others, even if they are not really deserving of it. God is releasing prisoners all over the world from addictions, from spiritual strongholds and mental prisons in the mind, as well as physical prisons. Do you want to be a part of this? Do you want to be free? You must know that God has called you to be a part of His kingdom, to set people free. I therefore want you to pray this prayer after me and rewind this audio clip if you have to, but repeat after me in sincerity. Lord, I am a sinner and I realize I have no part in you, unless I go through the door named Jesus. I confess that there is no other name, named in heaven or in the earth, that men should be saved. Thank you for delivering me. Thank you for setting me free and for what you are about to do in my life. I pray this in the name of Jesus, in whom I put my trust, and I thank you for the love that you are shedding abroad in my heart, even for my enemies. Amen. Friends, if this podcast blessed you, and I would ask you kindly to comment, like, or subscribe to this channel, and I hope that you and I meet again in the same place again very, very soon. God bless you and keep you, and have a wonderful day.